Si quieren venir, que vengan, les presentaremos batalla.
The Falklands War, that one war that Argentina fought in. You know the history, 149 years of bickering. You knew about the longtime British hold on the islands as part of its worldwide empire. And you knew about Argentina's continued objections, its seizure of the so-called Malvinas from Britain, and ultimately the crushing British response. But how much do you know about the leaders of these two countries and why they fought? You likely know Margaret Thatcher's story and her reasons for taking back the islands. You also likely know that she was opposed in this conflict by General Leopoldo Galtieri of Argentina, the head of a military government that was trying to save its legitimacy with the war. But how much do you really know about this comic book-style general who was once America's best friend before ultimately losing his power due to American weaponry? He was a man as brutal as they come, yet socially charming. You never quite knew what he was going to do or say next. Ultimately, his legacy is defeat. But let's dive deeper into the life and career of Leopoldo Fortunato Galtieri. Hey, it's Alex, writer and editor for Wayback History. Thanks for watching this mini-bio to kick off the channel. Our next project is going to be an exciting one. We'll look at some of the most complicated and fascinating political history ever as the ashes of the Habsburg Empire were swept away. It's the collapse of Austria-Hungary and the almost Anschluss. Next time on Wayback History. On July 15, 1926, Leopoldo Galtieri was born in Caseros, best known for the 1856 Battle of Caseros. He came from an Italian family. Leopoldo was the middle child of three siblings. After finishing high school in Caseros, Leopoldo joined the National Military College after turning 17 in the summer of 1943. The army was in the middle of taking on lots of middle-class officers, such as young Leopoldo, and a military council had also just taken power in the country, mainly thanks to the army. The navy's support for the corrupt civilian governments that came before gave the army legitimacy, as did their hiring of the middle class. So Leopoldo started at the academy, studying civil engineering. In 1945, the military handed power back to civilian leaders, but Leopoldo and his generation of army officers would always remain heavily influenced by the nationalist self-reliance promoted by the army during the 1943-45 regime. In 1949, Galtieri took a class at the School of the Americas in Panama. That's where he got his first exposure to American military doctrine. This school was known to specialize in the type of anti-communist operations used by Latin American countries during the Cold War, many of which were very controversial. Galtieri began lecturing at the Senior War College in Buenos Aires in 1958. Now, at this point, the country was once again under military rule and had been for the past 3 years after the military toppled the government of Juan Domingo Perón. Meanwhile, Galtieri traveled to the United States for the first time in 1960. He studied combat engineering at Fort Belvoir in Virginia for 6 months. Back in Buenos Aires, Galtieri received several promotions from the Senior War College, ultimately becoming director of the School of Engineering in 1964. He continually had his army rank promoted as well, becoming a brigadier general in 1972, the first time Galtieri had reached the rank of general. This was another period where the military was in control of the country. However, by 72, they were getting ready to give up power. Always known as an ardent nationalist, General Galtieri was at this time advocating the use of force by the army, both in the case of a border conflict with Chile or a renewed breakdown of internal order, once civilian rule returned. So essentially, Galtieri wanted to solve both possible issues using force to send a clear message, especially since the military would no longer be in power and would therefore need to reestablish its authority. As the new civilian rule returned none other than Juan Perón himself to power in 1973, the stage was set for a course of events that would lead the country down a sad and violent path, Argentina's descent into hell. In 1973, internal chaos was back. immediately upon Perón's return to Argentina after his election, he arrived in the country to a mass rally at the airport of both his left and right-wing supporters. Many of the leftists in this crowd were part of a Trotskyist radical faction called the Montoneros. They had uncompromising demands. Right-wing hardliner Peronists were there too, and Peronism, as a uniting force, went up in smoke literally right there on the spot as rightist snipers opened fire on leftists in the crowd, killing dozens and injuring hundreds. This caused a sudden and immediate internal conflict throughout Argentina. The seeds of potential civil war were being sown, the Montoneros radicalized into a leftist terrorist organization, and other leftist guerrilla armies also began mobilizing in the country as well. President Perón himself sided with the establishment and empowered his assistant, José López Rega, to begin purging Perón's leftist supporters and closing trade unions. Strangely, the Montoneros were not yet officially banned from Peronism. As Perón turned to the right to guard against revolution, a violent response from the state was enacted against the mobilizing leftist political and economic leaders. They were viewed as enablers for the guerrillas, and the Argentine Federal Police, under the influence of López Rega, responded to this by assassinating and arresting union leaders and deposing leftist officials throughout the country. Early the next year, 1974, General Galtieri was moved to head the 7th Infantry Brigade. He did support the government's efforts to suppress the militants. However, early in the year, the Argentine army was not yet directly involved in the civil conflict, which came to be known as the Dirty War, and would last for 8 years. In late 1973 and early 1974, the Montoneros and their allies launched a series of high-profile bombings throughout Argentina, including against the head of Perón's labor syndicate. Perón called the Montoneros out for the murder at a rally at Plaza de Mayo in Buenos Aires, banning the left-wingers from his Peronist movement and Justicialist party. Further, Perón empowered López Rega to create a right-wing paramilitary death squad known as the Argentine Anti-Communist Alliance. The AAA's general command would work in tandem with the police and the military to quell the unrest. The AAA would also go ahead with their own bombing and assassinations of leftist leaders in response. Plus, the military and police would work to assassinate and arrest the militants themselves. In July, Juan Perón died. His vice president and widow, his third wife Isabel, took over as president of Argentina. After a brief peace following Perón's death, I guess long enough for both sides to remember that Perón had once united them, the state of violent civil unrest returned. Through 1974 and into 75, the situation continued to deteriorate to near civil war, as bombings were a daily occurrence in the country. The police, AAA, and intelligence services committed kidnappings, assassinations, and bombings on behalf of the state, while the Montoneros, the ERP, and other militants with Cuban support engaged in sieges, assassinations, and bombings on behalf of leftist and communist revolutionaries. This orgy of violence and state-sanctioned murder would ultimately enable the rise of Galtieri to power and set in motion the events leading to the Falklands War. General Galtieri's launch point may have been August 27, 1975, when President Isabel Perón named a new army chief, General Jorge Rafael Videla. Videla appointed Galtieri vice head of state of the Argentine army, in addition to commanding the 2nd Army Corps in Rosario, Santa Fe. Isabel Perón and José López Rega's economic shock therapy and right-wing death squads proved, well, unpopular, to say the least. He had become a lightning rod due to state support for the AAA and his rumored occult tendencies. Isabel was seen by the neutral majority somewhat in the way the Russian Tsarina was once viewed, while José López Rega played the nefarious role of Rasputin. So she exiled López Rega to Spain on a diplomatic mission. With López Rega out, Isabel appeared powerless, and the military would fill this power vacuum. General Galtieri now commanded forces of the entire Santa Fe province, with his base still in Rosario. On October 6th, while officially still on sick leave, President Isabel Perón established martial law in Argentina and gave the military blanket immunity to, quote, annihilate subversives throughout the country, end quote. In 1975, two Spanish citizens disappeared from Rosario. Ramiro Montesinos, the Spanish consul in the city from 75 to 77, reported that he confronted Galtieri, suspecting that they may have been kidnapped by government forces. Galtieri reportedly held up a briefcase belonging to one of the missing men, showed it to Montesinos, saying, "This man was a subversive." Galtieri also implied that there were government forces and that they were under his control. Galtieri would be charged nearly 30 years later, but died before the trial. Army Chief Videla took the annihilation order very seriously and was quoted as saying, "A terrorist is not just someone with a gun or a bomb, but also someone who spreads ideas that are contrary to Western and Christian civilization." The violence just kept intensifying. Despite her attempts to project strength, the armed forces' confidence in Isabel Perón to restore order and suppress communism was beginning to disintegrate. As the bombings and revenge kidnappings continued, along with outright guerrilla war in certain rural provinces. After an easily foiled Air Force coup attempt against Isabel Perón, followed by the militant siege of a state armory, both in December 1975, Videla began to lock down the country. The word terrorist or subversive began to apply to not just militants, but their friends and families as well, and also to Argentine nationals abroad in Spain and other countries. Videla used the martial law to kill any potential opponents of the Argentine government or its armed forces. On March 15th of the next year, the Montoneros car-bombed Videla's army headquarters in Buenos Aires. With inflation at 700%, the country's business leaders gave the military the green light to overthrow the president. On March 24th, 1976, President Isabel Perón was deposed by the military and put under house arrest, while Congress was suspended and the country was put under the control of a three-man council, or junta, consisting of the Army, Navy, and Air Force chiefs. The three ruled together for the first week, with the new military government being known as the National Process of Reorganization, or El Proceso, the process. On March 29th, Army Chief Videla, zealot of the dirty war himself, was sworn in as Argentina's president by the junta. As president, Videla would keep martial law firmly in place and expand the dirty war to new levels, attempting to root out leftist sympathizers in the civilian population. Thousands of students, teachers, labor leaders, politicians, and their families were, quote, disappeared to detention centers across the country, where they were tortured and many killed by AAA members, Argentine military men, or intelligence officers. The Navy chief, Emilio Massera, set up detention centers under the Navy's watch and directed the dirty war against the civilian population, including students and academia. The Army continued to fight the communist rebels, while its head, President Videla, took most of the international blame for the dirty war. He later accepted this, saying, "My officers followed my commands during the internal war." One of his officers was General Galtieri, who was quick to follow Videla's anti-communist line. Galtieri's exact role in this phase of the internal war is unclear. His loyalty to Videla and his staunch anti-communist beliefs earned him social points within the army. As such, in 1977, Videla promoted Galtieri to Major General. Videla was allowed to both sit on the junta and serve as president for the first 2 years of El Proceso, effectively making him an unchecked dictator as he finished the dirty business of the dirty war. However, the military council attempted to rein in Videla's power in 1978. By this time, the dirty war was effectively finished, and most of the civilians who had been tortured were now released or dead, although many thousands remained in camps being tortured. The Navy and Air Force wanted to move on from Videla, who had become a controversial figure around the world. However, he retained the support of the Army, which was the muscle behind the junta at this point. Videla was sworn in for 3 more years on March 29, 1978. Videla was, however, replaced as Army Chief by General Roberto Viola, who is now effectively next in line for the presidency. Viola's two biggest supporters for the role were the president, General Videla himself, but also General Galtieri, who was gaining influence. Viola began stacking Videla's cabinet with his own loyalists. However, he was unable to uproot José Martínez de Oz, the finance minister, who continued the policies that had been sinking the economy in the 2 years leading up to the coup. Thus, after initially stabilizing and even bumping up, the economy was continuing to sink under the military government. This meant that Army Chief Viola, scheduled to become president in 1981, would potentially be dealing with a renewed crisis. In preparation, Viola stepped down from the junta in 1979, also expressing a desire to avoid electing himself president, quote-unquote, in 2 years. Meanwhile, Major General Leopoldo Galtieri was named head of the Argentine Army under Videla, his payoff for a lifetime of service. However, if Viola thought that Galtieri would be playing his loyal role as a Viola supporter, he was mistaken. See, now Galtieri had real power as head of the army, so he could stop playing his role as a technocratic officer and now had the freedom to do as he saw fit within the army. As army chief, he easily would have the sway to affect Videla's government policy, especially since the military was running the government. Army Chief Galtieri immediately began making moves to shore up his power base. He coerced Viola's favorite generals to retire in late 1979, and he helped get rid of Viola loyalists in Videla's cabinet. General Galtieri set about establishing himself as an international and domestic brand name. Here we see the general on the TV program Forward Youth, cigarette in hand and a bombastic swagger about him that was absent from all the other junta leaders, aside from President Videla. Galtieri's main goal was to gain support from the United States of America, which had tolerated Videla's regime to that point. The American intelligence services had worked closely with Videla's, but were souring on the idea of continued military rule in Argentina due to bad publicity for the U.S. from its connections to the Dirty War. In 1980, Galtieri sent Argentina's infamous 601st Intelligence Battalion to support the so-called cocaine coup junta in Bolivia and to Peru on an assassination mission, both in support of U.S. interests. Galtieri was later indicted on charges stemming from the murders committed by members of the 601st. Galtieri also took political advantage of Viola's temporary status as a civilian while he was out of the government, as he forbade his former boss from contacting President Videla or lobbying any of his generals. But Galtieri also knew how to play the game of power, and thus when the military junta voted for a new president on October 3, 1980, Galtieri did throw the full weight of the army's support behind Viola. Although the Navy was reluctant to accept Viola as president, they eventually relented. So when Jorge Videla retired after 5 years in power on March 29, 1981, General Roberto Viola became president for a scheduled 3-year term. It was rival Galtieri who presented Viola with the presidential sash and scepter. President Viola attempted to begin implementing the plan that he had been developing for 2 years since resigning from the army to fix the nation's deepening economic crisis, but he ended up being undermined right from the start and from all sides. He wasn't helped by the 9% devaluation in Argentina's currency just before he took office. Galtieri had stacked the army with his own loyalists, and now with Videla out of the way, Galtieri was emboldened to make aggressive displays of his staunch anti-communist militarism to try and brand himself as an American ally abroad. The Americans did not approve of Viola's economic strategy, so Galtieri undermined it as well, and instead promoted Martínez de Oz's previously struggling strategies, which were supported by multinational U.S. companies. In April, Galtieri closed the Argentine border with Chile over a long-running border dispute in the Tierra del Fuego at the southern tip of the two countries. This came in open defiance of Pope John Paul II, who was attempting to broker a settlement from Rome, and in defiance of the Americans, who were supporters of the Chilean regime itself. However, more importantly than this was the fact that Galtieri had closed Argentina's western border entirely of his own accord, without consulting Viola, a message to the international community that he was the one to deal with in Argentina and held the real power. This worked, at least on the United States. The Americans had invited Viola to meet with Reagan shortly before becoming president. However, in August 1981, they invited Galtieri to tour U.S. military bases. While there, Galtieri hit it off with Reagan administration officials who admired Galtieri's larger-than-life image, gruff demeanor, and staunch anti-communist stance. During the trip, Reagan's national security advisor even referred to Galtieri as, quote, the majestic general. The U.S. began sending support to the Argentine army for the purpose of training the now-famous Nicaraguan Contras, which at that time were not public knowledge yet. But the Argentine army began to train the Contras in August of 1981. Galtieri also sent Argentine support for U.S. efforts in El Salvador. This kind of international sway, along with Viola getting caught up in the trappings of power, allowed Galtieri to make sweeping changes to the government and put even more loyalists into positions of power. In early November, Galtieri was back in the United States, and after a conference with other Latin American military leaders, Galtieri proudly proclaimed, quote, Argentina and the United States will march together in the ideological battle that is being waged in the world, end quote. On November 9th, General Viola was ousted by a military coup, officially for, quote, medical reasons, and an acting administration within the junta took over on a temporary basis. Galtieri, as head of the army, made it known that he was consulting with his generals about this power vacuum. In early December, it was announced that Admiral Jorge Anaya of the Argentine Navy had forged an alliance with Galtieri and his generals, which would restore the presidency to a sitting junta member. The only obvious choice for president was Galtieri himself, who, despite being ahead of a rival service branch, had set things up perfectly for him to be the man for this moment, with both support at home and in the military, abroad in the USA and across the world. And beyond Galtieri's status as the favorite, Anaya also admired Galtieri's use force first and ask questions later philosophy. See, Anaya had been planning for a Navy-dominated war for the Falklands, or the Malvinas, since the 1960s. However, the aristocratic Navy had steadily lost influence to the Army, and with Army Chief Galtieri being the obvious choice for president, Anaya sought to use this opportunity for his own ambitions. Anaya thought Galtieri would agree with him that a Falklands War was the only solution to save the military regime and distract the public from the deepening economic crisis. At this time, the announcement was made that, along with Anaya becoming head of the Navy, Galtieri was going to become Argentina's next president. Galtieri was sworn in on the 22nd of December, and on the 23rd, he gave his inaugural address to the nation on both television and radio. Galtieri needed to answer a multitude of questions being hurled at the government by a fast-growing network of opposition forces. The main opposition group that Galtieri was speaking to was the Multipartidaria, a coalition of all of Argentina's now banned political parties. Now, given that the military was in control of the country, these were civilian forces that were not violent, and thus they had a sense of legitimacy to them, and the government was compelled to let them operate and also, to an extent, listen to their demands. Galtieri started by saying that he understood the frustration the public felt with the government, and that the time for words was over. The time for action was beginning now. Galtieri said he was going to fix the economy and restore the country's faith in the military. First up was the economy. Galtieri said he needed to impose strict austerity measures on the Argentine people. This included wage freezes and an end to protest strikes, which had begun to become an issue under Viola. However, Galtieri also promised that the government would stop borrowing and spending so much money, would slash its budget, and would liberalize the economy, meaning that companies which had been nationalized previously would now be denationalized and sold to private investors with a plan to come within 4 months. Galtieri also announced that within 2 months, he would denationalize and therefore depoliticize official groups and civic organizations in the country, and that within the two-month time frame, he would be announcing political reforms as well. Finally, Galtieri stated there would be no change in Argentina's foreign policy, but that measures would be coming to restore Argentinians' faith in their military. After Christmas, the Multipartidaria released its response. The parties called for free elections at both the state and national level for 1984, with this demand issued at the end of December 1981, so this gave the government a little over 2 years to figure something out. Galtieri was joined on the stage by his fellow junta members, Admiral Anaya, along with Air Force Brigadier General Basilio Lamidoso. Now, as Galtieri took care of the political and economic side of things, Anaya and Lamidoso were preparing for the war. However, due to the Air Force's perceived inferiority, infighting between the Navy and Air Force would continue not only through the planning period, but all the way into the conflict itself. Galtieri and Anaya worked better together, with Galtieri having already planned most of the Army's part in the coming conflict. Meanwhile, Galtieri's austerity measures were becoming very unpopular in the country, as people did not have money and they were not seeing the benefits of the liberalization of businesses. Meanwhile, the liberalization of politics that Galtieri had promised within 2 months, he delivered, perhaps due to the growing discontent. Galtieri announced that soon civilian governors would be returning as they would replace their military stand-ins. Galtieri also announced that this would likely precede national presidential elections. See, Galtieri and Anaya had come up with a plan to keep the military in power by making themselves national heroes in battle. The plan was simple. Go for the path of least resistance. Well, half of that was easy. The Falklands had never looked like an easier target. The British had been giving up colonies for decades now, and it looked like the British Empire was pretty much at its end. On the other side of things, because of indoctrination since birth, there was nothing the Argentine population desired more than to recapture the Malvinas. Not that the Argentine people would feel that the dirty war was a price that was worth it to recapture the barren archipelago, but they did feel like the military regime owed them something. Plus, Galtieri and Anaya both knew that their only chance for long-term power would be in that planned 1984 election. So at the time, it really looked like Galtieri had nothing to lose by taking the islands. And if the British weren't going to do anything to save the Falklands, they certainly weren't going to do anything to save South Georgia and its population of under 100. Anaya truly did not believe that the British would respond in the Atlantic. He and Galtieri agreed that the most likely outcome would be that the British and possibly the Americans would support Chile and Augusto Pinochet in a proxy war against Argentina. However, Galtieri believed that he had the magic touch with the Americans and believed that the United States would side with Argentina over Britain and Chile. As such, Galtieri planned for not only defensive action while the Falklands War was going on, but once the Falklands and South Georgia were secure, he planned offensive action into western Patagonia. The Argentine military greatly outnumbered Chile's, and it would likely be no contest, with Galtieri betting that the Americans would back him up. This plan, to create a sort of empire, was designed to make Galtieri a national hero and guarantee a landslide victory in the 1984 presidential election. The initial seeds of the war were planted on March 19th by the Argentine side on British South Georgia. A group of Argentine Marines infiltrated a scrap metal transport boat on the way to Leith Harbor. The ship and the scrapyard were owned by a Scottish company, which had gotten on the wrong side of the military junta. The Marines raised the Argentine flag over the scrapyard and were immediately commanded to take it down. They were also commanded to meet the British at once. The Argentines lowered the flag, but took 3 days to leave. The British stepped up their presence in the area as a response. Galtieri's government would be backed into a corner, but not by the British, instead by the Argentine people. On March 30th, huge protests were called for across the country by the General Confederation of Workers and the Multipartidaria. The main group of protesters, which numbered over 100,000, descended on Buenos Aires, attempting to march all the way to the Plaza del Mayo and stop in front of the Casa Rosada, the official residence of the president. Except for the now famous Mothers of the Disappeared, the military regime had never allowed a protest during its 7 years in power, and it didn't intend on this one being the first. They didn't let the protesters reach the Plaza del Mayo, as intercepting them were security officers who detained thousands, including the leaders of the movement. This was clearly a desperate moment for the Argentine government, and the military knew that this was the time for action. If there was ever a moment to go ahead with the operation, this was it. On April 1st, battleships and troop transports began leaving the east coast of Argentina, bound for the Falklands. The British did notice, but they weren't sure how serious the Argentines were, plus they didn't have the means to respond anyway. Anaya had the Navy set up makeshift bases on uninhabited islands around the Falklands, as Galtieri prepared to formally invade the next day. At 4:30 a.m., a stealth unit landed on the Falklands and captured an airstrip. About 2 hours later, the islands were overwhelmed by several amphibious landings, in addition to a major battle where the Argentines captured the Falklands capital, Port Stanley. The world looked on in disbelief as the Falklands officially surrendered. It's also worth noting that all the troops that captured the islands were professional soldiers. There was shock around the world as the stunned international community debated how Britain would respond. It was widely speculated, and 10 days later declared, that a maritime exclusion zone of 230 miles or 200 nautical miles would be created by the British. However, at this point, it was mostly just a warning, as the British regrouped and got ready to deploy a task force. The task force, once it arrived, would enforce the exclusion zone. Any opposition vessels or planes were liable to be destroyed immediately. Galtieri responded to this by holding a public speech on the Plaza del Mayo. An amazing scene unfolded, where just days before they had come to protest the military and oust Galtieri, now the general was a god amongst men in the eyes of his people. And the crowd looked on adoring as Galtieri laid out his response to a potential British attack.
Que sepa el mundo, América, que un pueblo con voluntad. Pueblo argentino, si quieren venir, que vengan, les presentaremos batalla.
This was clearly Galtieri's moment in the sun. Despite the strong words, Galtieri still expected America to back him up. He knew the British would likely look to the Chileans to solve their problems, so Galtieri looked to America for support. At first, it looked like he was partially correct, as the U.S. told Britain to think twice about sending that Navy task force. Emboldened, Anaya directed operations against South Georgia. Argentina also took over several uninhabited islands in the area, known collectively as South Sandwich. Now don't forget about that 200 nautical mile exclusion zone, even if the Argentines are doing their best to ignore it at this point. Margaret Thatcher had declined the American request to call off the task force. Both sides knew South Georgia was likely to be the initial target of the British. While Argentina's professional army went back to the mainland to defend the Chilean border, the Argentine Navy and Air Force prepared for the British to arrive. Not only did the Argentines have almost no defense prepared, but they also didn't believe that the British would actually attack. Galtieri was gambling on either the British backing down or the Americans forcing them to back down. The Argentines were in for a rude awakening, as 2 weeks later the Americans showed up, not to back the Argentines, but in fact to hash out a deal between Britain and Argentina. American Secretary of State Alexander Haig came to Buenos Aires, where he met with Galtieri for several days of talks, which, while chummy, were not all that productive. Galtieri was still hoping to get the Americans on side, and early in the meeting he asked why, with all of its resources, the U.S. couldn't stop the British. Haig said the Americans were willing to prevent hostilities, but Argentina would first need to accept that they may not get the islands in arbitration. Well, each time Galtieri brought these proposals back to the junta, it was firmly rejected. The Americans, getting nowhere with Argentina, gave up and decided to just sell weapons to the British to end it quickly. As an admirer of America, Galtieri took this as a betrayal, but his refusal to back down solidified his position at home. Galtieri further tried to solidify this position on the 22nd by becoming the first Argentine president ever to visit the Malvinas. Galtieri was enjoying his newfound popularity, and he made a show out of the trip, inviting 60 Minutes Argentina to go along with him, interviewing him in the plane on the way over, following him from event to event, and providing plenty of visual proof for those back home that the islands were now Argentina's. Galtieri did continue to pay lip service to both sides, and as he sat down for a long televised interview at the end of the day, he repeatedly struck a conciliatory tone with the United States and Britain, saying that Argentina was willing to continue the dialogue. However, this was mostly just for the cameras, as even in this interview, Galtieri made no real concessions. The previous day in South Georgia, the British had lost two helicopters trying to land on Fortuna Glacier. The wide open ice sheet provided a great angle for reconnaissance and for a surprise attack aimed at the capital, Grytviken. However, extreme gale force winds crashed two of the helicopters and forced the British to turn back and rescue the crew. Although everyone escaped unharmed, the British had tipped the Argentines off to their presence. However, Anaya was unable to respond quickly enough. On April 25th, the British bombarded the ARA Santa Fe submarine. Although it didn't sink, it was forced to return to South Georgia, and its crew later surrendered. However, when the British thought one crewman was sabotaging the captured vessel, he was shot and killed, the first casualty of the conflict. The British then shelled the hills near Grytviken, and it surrendered before a shot was even fired in the town. The following day, Leith Harbor surrendered, and South Georgia was officially back in British hands. However, this news was not broadcast back in Argentina, and the population at large was led to believe that Argentina was winning the war. Galtieri made the decision to hide the truth from his people to buy Anaya time to get the naval situation under control. On April 30th, the exclusion zone was upgraded to a total exclusion zone, which essentially meant that any non-British vessel or aircraft near the islands was liable to be destroyed. Argentina's ARA General Belgrano, a light cruiser, was heading back toward the Argentine coast and the Falklands. Meanwhile, the British Naval Task Force was just days away. The next day, action moved to the islands themselves. The Black Buck air raids destroyed the runways of Stanley and forced Lamidozo to start all air missions from the Argentine mainland. However, the Black Buck raids initiated from even further away in the Ascension Islands, a 16-hour round trip. Galtieri was anxious to end the naval war. He wanted to strike a blow at the British to show them he meant business and then turn his attention to Chile. Navy Chief Anaya was only too happy to oblige this, as both men knew the British had to be defeated at sea. On May 2nd, Anaya ordered a pincer movement, An Argentine task force would leave from Buenos Aires or another port in the north, while the Belgrano and other ships would attack from the south. In this way, they hoped to catch the British off guard and possibly surround them. However, the British Navy is still the British Navy, and they sent the submarine fleet to track several Argentine cruisers. One of these was the General Belgrano, and as it pivoted towards the east to go back on the attack, the HMS Conqueror sunk it, killing 323 Argentines, while another nearly 800 men needed to be rescued. Anaya shockingly responded by pulling the Navy out of the war completely, and saving the Navy's efforts for the possible war with Chile. Even though the press was censored, news that the General Belgrano had been sunk got out in Argentina. President Galtieri knew that he needed to respond. The Argentines considered the Belgrano attack a cheap shot because it had not been in the exclusion zone. However, they later did admit that it was on offensive operations at the time that it was sunk. But with Anaya pulling out of the war, it was up to Lamidozo to deliver the strike. And he did, as the Argentines got their revenge by sinking the HMS Sheffield with an Exocet missile, killing 20. On May 11th, 42-year-old American reporter Christopher Jones of the superstation Channel 5 New York asked a couple of tough questions at an Argentine-Venezuelan joint press conference. After the conference, Jones was seized by three men outside the foreign ministry, thrown into a vehicle, and driven around while being slapped, robbed, stripped, and then thrown outside naked on a back way while his cameramen were kidnapped and robbed of all their footage and equipment. Galtieri's government blamed this on AAA-related groups, who were now being used to do the junta's dirty work while being publicly thrown under the bus by the regime. The government's crisis of action regarding the war turned into a blame game, with the foreign press, especially of course the British press, being the object of both negative propaganda and very real harassment. 2 days later, at the same spot outside the foreign ministry, a surreal series of events involving a British reporter began much the same way as the Jones incident. 31-year-old Julian Mannion of London's Thames TV, along with his two technicians, were ushered into a waiting Ford Falcon, known to be the vehicle of choice for the military. Their producer fled back to the hotel and was not pursued, and their driver was also kidnapped but later released. Nearly 4 hours later, the three men, having been robbed of all their money and equipment, were released naked 20 miles away from Buenos Aires. Earlier that afternoon, Mannion's crew had been attempting to question the Argentine foreign minister, Nicanor Costa Mendez, about a meeting with the junta. Costa Mendez had taken exception to the question and demanded to see their credentials just minutes before the kidnapping. That night, after finding some clothes, Mannion and the Thames crew were invited to meet with the Interior Minister, General Alfredo Escarcenchen, who said he knew nothing about the kidnapping. Due to the rare opportunity to interview a high-ranking official, they accepted, and it only gets more surreal from there.
When we returned, we were taken immediately at the invitation of the Interior Minister to the Presidential Palace, where he presented us with his views of the situation and then introduced us to the President himself, Leopoldo Galtieri, and I was then able to take the opportunity of asking the President how he now views the war, the crisis with Britain, and the efforts to settle it. What chances are there now of a negotiated settlement, in your opinion, of this war?
Mientras hay diálogo, mientras hay canales de comunicación, podemos conversar para buscar ese objetivo en un plazo razonable. Pero no 149 años más.
But not 149 years more.
Galtieri was at his charismatic best during this surreal late-night interview following the kidnapping. This was the only interview with Galtieri during the conflict, and he knew the world was watching. On this world stage, Galtieri didn't back down an inch. Perhaps emboldened by some liquid courage, Galtieri doubled down on Argentina's claims in front of the whole world. He was signaling to his own people and to the world that he was ready for a fight.
Tiene vocación de llegar a una solución. no militar a problema. Sin embargo, si la Gran Bretaña sigue usando con mayor intensidad sus medios militares, la Argentina está espiritualmente y militarmente preparada para responder.
Argentina is spiritually and militarily ready to answer.
This was clearly Galtieri's high water mark. The descent towards low tide began the very next day. British forces raided the Argentine airstrip at Pebble Island. The daring sabotage mission was a success, with the Argentine commander killed and 11 Argentine aircraft destroyed. For the second time in this war, Argentina was now forced to fly their planes from the mainland. And once again, Lamidozzo's forces were up to the challenge, even without help from the Navy. With the air threat lessened, the Falklands were ripe for an invasion. The pressure of defending the islands was now squarely on Galtieri's shoulders. The Malvinas were in the hands of the army. However, Galtieri hadn't taken the British threat very seriously. And with the professional army on the Chilean border, 18 and 19-year-old conscripts made up the bulk of the Argentine force in the Falklands. The conditions were cold, miserable, and like the rest of the population, the soldiers didn't have food. Well, their commanding officers did. But they didn't. This was one of several accusations later leveled at General Galtieri for his handling of the Falklands War. Officers not only starved their troops, but also allegedly beat and tortured them, subjecting Argentina's warm-weather conscripts to brutal ice-cold trench conditions would stain the reputation of the Argentine army at home. Though at this point, nobody on either side knew about this, and on the 21st, attention focused on East Falkland. The British attempted an amphibious landing at San Carlos Water with 4,000 troops. To defend this, the British brought a small force of ships. Again, though, it was Lamidozzo who provided the Argentine response, sending low-flying planes from the mainland to strafe the islands, keeping underneath British radar, and then bombing the British ships in Falkland Sound. The sound became known as Bomb Alley, as the battle between the British Navy and Argentine Air Force raged for 4 days. While the battle was fought to a draw and both sides sustained losses, the British had more than enough opportunity to land 4,000 troops on East Falkland. While the Argentines did outnumber them, the British had all the advantage in professional experience and in training. The British Marines also had a larger presence on the island than the Argentine Special Forces. As Argentina braced for a fight, its occupation of the islands became more and more tenuous by the day. The British were not without setbacks, though, as Lamidozzo's forces took out their helicopters, which were supposed to take the troops across the island. This gave the Argentine troops on the island a chance to dig in. The majority of the British force now had to endure a long, cold, hard march to Stanley. The rest of them would run into an Argentine death trap at Goose Green. A British contingent was sent to capture the town for an early morale-boosting victory. This was the first major ground battle of the war, and the Argentine garrison was putting up an impressive fight. The Argentines had the high ground, and they refused to give it up all night long. The British had been assaulting the Argentine positions from the middle of an open plain, so when the sun came up, the British were target practice. Britain finally captured the position, but only after a heroic, all-time act of bravery by Colonel H. Jones. Jones commanded the British force assaulting Goose Green and gave up his life in an attempt to outflank the Argentine position. This heroic and solemn act of sacrifice united the British troops, and all of a sudden the Argentine defenses collapsed. As they were pushed back into the town, this is where many of the Argentine abuses of their own troops were alleged to have occurred. The conscripts needed to remain in the trenches and hold down Goose Green at any cost. The Argentines put up a tremendous fight, launching a successful ambush operation and also using anti-aircraft guns to keep the British at arm's length. The British fought all the way to the schoolhouse, being used as a base by the Argentines. Argentine commander Italo Angel Piaggi realized no reinforcements were coming from Stanley and decided the only honorable action he could take for his men was to surrender. That being said, while the commander himself was never accused of any war crimes, his understudies were accused of mistreating and abusing their troops. Piaggi would be under fire in court for his quick surrender. However, he was able to prove his competence and later re-earned his military pension. Even the English-speaking locals showed up to honor the memory of Colonel H. Jones, who had died defending their islands from the Argentinians. In the bigger picture, the British raised the Union Jack above Goose Green, and all of a sudden the Argentines were firmly on the ropes, controlling just Port Stanley in the hills to the west. At one of these hills, Mount Simon, there was an abandoned shepherd's house known as Top Mallow. At this house, a garrison of Argentine Special Forces held the strong point. The 12 Argentine Special Forces soldiers were encountered by 19 British Marines on May 31st. Despite the small numbers, these were the elite troops of both sides. The British had marched through a snowstorm the night before just to be here, and they certainly weren't going to be driven backward. Two Argentine Special Forces were killed, and the British captured the vital strong point. Over the previous few days, the Argentine conscripts in the area surrounding Mount Kent would occasionally come under fire and suffer losses at the hands of British Special Forces. By the time Top Mallow fell on the 31st, these skirmishes were finished. All in all, the losses were fairly minimal on each side. However, the assault aircraft and supply aircraft on both sides came under heavy attack, and as such, the soldiers on the ground for both sides were largely starving, and no clean water was available. British pilot Jerry Pook was later given the Distinguished Flying Cross after his plane was shot down by small arms fire, and he survived, later returning to lead his squadron. However, after the British shot down an Argentine helicopter with a surface-to-air missile, the Argentines then retreated from Mount Kent while covering their retreat by launching an Exocet missile at the HMS Invincible. As the British closed in on Stanley, Galtieri's propaganda machine was in full gear. As an attempt to maintain calm and unity at home, the Argentine media reported on cue that the Invincible had been sunk. However, the ship was later seen returning to Britain almost undamaged. The media conveniently ignored that the Argentine supply of exocets had been cut off by the French and that tanks were part of the British force surrounding Stanley. With the situation close to hopeless, Galtieri assigned the best troops he had left in the Falklands to the defense of Stanley. British troops from Goose Green had marched to the Bluff Cove area. However, their position was relatively exposed, and they had no natural defenses to the north. 5,000 Welsh and Scottish reinforcements were brought in. But how were the reinforcements going to get to Bluff Cove? Marching would take too long. Too many helicopters had been destroyed in Argentine air attacks on British transports, and there was no place to unload a transport ship. Some of the troops who were already on the island retreated to San Carlos, where a flotilla of transport ships and also landing craft from larger transport ships made up a combined British task force designed to drop the reinforcements at Bluff Cove. On the 7th, the transport boats arrived, and some troops began disembarking on the landing craft. However, they weren't sure at first whether they were supposed to land at the nearby town where the British garrison was, or whether they were supposed to meet Tupara at Bluff Cove, which is a little further up the coast. They chose the latter option, trying to bypass a broken bridge that had been sabotaged by the Argentines. However, this indecisiveness caused the landings to spill into the 8th, and although the British felt safe from air attacks due to the poor weather, not just throughout this part of the campaign, but throughout the entire war, they were suddenly greeted by much clearer skies during the night of the 7th into the 8th. As morning dawned, the British continued to land troops, even under clear blue skies. Air Force General Lomidozo's forces attacked at 2 p.m. 5 Argentine Skyhawks attacked 2 large British transports, each of them carrying enough troops for several landing craft. 5 Argentine bombs struck the 2 British ships, doing damage to the RFA Sir Tristan, but almost totally demolishing her sister Sir Galahad. 50 British troops, 48 of them on the Sir Galahad, perished. Later, the Argentines would return to bomb a landing craft, killing 6 more British Marines. After this, the British shot down 3 of the Skyhawks, killing their pilots, but the damage was done. The British were demoralized, as one of the defining images of the war would come to be helicopters hovering and rescuing men from the burning ships. It was the Argentines' largest victory of the war. However, the Argentine military governor of the Falklands, Mario Menendez, overplayed his hand. Or more accurately, his subordinates did, as they approached him with the news that over 900 British had been killed. Because of this, Menendez expected the British to call off the assault on Stanley. Well, as it turned out, the British were delayed, but the assault was still just days away. Coming off the victory at sea, Galtieri invited U.S. officers, along with local regime supporters, to the Casa Rosada for a gigantic barbecue. American Colonel McHenry would attend and would discuss with the Argentines what the plan was going forward for peace. The Argentines wanted nothing less than full sovereignty over the Malvinas. Thus, at this point, with the British losses mounting, it looked like a potential ceasefire could be on the cards, in which the British public, tired of their boys dying for the sake of an Antarctic rock, would force Thatcher's government to withdraw from the Falklands. This was the route to victory for Argentina: make the British leave, and then sign an agreement giving full sovereignty to Argentina. At this time, it looked like a real possibility, but even after their worst defeat of the war, the British launched an all-out assault. The port at Bluff Cove served the settlement of Fitzroy, which was held by the British troops. On the 10th of June, Menendez considered launching a counterattack at the British in this area. However, his subordinates were already preparing for a siege of Stanley. Menendez ultimately decided not to go ahead with the assault, and instead to fortify the hills surrounding Stanley. The British were preparing for an assault the next day. Menendez's defense in depth strategy called for the fortification of the western faces of the 3 outer peaks, with the definitive high ground of the Stanley area being the second layer of the defense, Mount Tumbledown. The last resort would be street-to-street fighting in the capital itself, an idea that would grow out of hand later on. On the southern part of the front, a British garrison snuck behind the Argentine lines, or at least partially so, by taking the road south of Mount Harriet. They moved just after nightfall, and later in the night they attacked. The fighting took place across wide open mountain slopes, many of them steep, in a very precarious situation for both sides. The Argentines had failed to fortify their southern flank, and now it was an open firefight for the mountain. With no real fortifications to protect them, the Argentines capitulated relatively quickly, and although the losses were minimal on each side, the British captured the strong point and took a whopping 300 Argentine prisoners. Meanwhile, in the center of the front, the domineering Two Sisters Mountain needed to be scaled, so on the same night the British assaulted there too, having to once again climb up a steep mountain slope to attack heavily fortified Argentine positions. This was a clear moonlit night, providing great visibility for Argentine machine gunners. The losses on each side were higher than at Mount Harriet. However, the Argentines were able to evacuate to the east. Still, the British won the battle and took 54 more Argentine prisoners. The night of the 11th into the 12th also featured an assault on Mount Longdon by the British. This would turn into the bloodiest land battle of the war. Argentina lost over 30 troops and 50 more were captured. While it wasn't an easy victory for the British, and they certainly had their fair share of losses, they had also pushed the Argentines back. Tumbledown and the nearby Wireless Ridge was the only remaining Argentine strong point on the road to Stanley. Overall, the three battles on the night of the 11th had led to the capture of over 400 Argentine troops, not all of them conscripts, many of them reservists. The remaining reservists and conscripts were now moved into Stanley itself, with the best of the units available in the Falklands now guarding Mount Tumbledown. The Argentines also attempted to hurt the British logistics surrounding these operations. Despite being out of land-based Exocet missiles, Menendez commandeered two Exocets from the Argentine Navy, specifically from the ARA Seguí, and had a special missile launcher built just outside Stanley to launch them. At 6 a.m. on the 12th, the Argentine counterattack consisted of an Exocet missile striking at the British destroyer HMS Glamorgan. The Argentines called the jerry-rigged missile launcher the Trashy Missile Platform. But the missile had deadly effectiveness, penetrating the ship's hangar and killing 14 British sailors. The ship, however, survived, and the British plans were not set back. Panic set in amongst some of the Argentine officers and troops guarding the capital. The Argentines knew that the only way to prevent a siege was to stop the British from taking Mount Tumbledown. To that end, the Argentines devoted all their resources to defending the hill, the last remaining strong point. During the early morning darkness on June 13th, the Argentines began sporadic mortarings and snipings from the hill. As the sun rose, the shelling continued all day unabated, as the Argentines apparently were going to spend all their remaining munitions to keep the British away. The British sent the battle-hardened veterans of Goose Green to the north to range around the Argentines and stage an attack at Wireless Ridge to the north of Tumbledown. Wireless Ridge was also the key to controlling the northern road to Stanley. The Argentines knew that the British would stage at least a diversionary attack there. The British were one step ahead, with their diversionary attack coming south of Tumbledown at Mount William. The British then caught the Argentines off guard by sending the battle-hardened 2 Para to attack Wireless Ridge. This was another brutal struggle for the high ground, and although the Argentines fought well, they sustained heavy casualties and were forced to retreat. This was followed at 9 p.m. by the full-scale British assault on Mount Tumbledown. The Argentines launched a furious defense, digging in on the mountain with not only conscripts, but also the Marines and other professional soldiers. This Argentine force was bombarded continuously by the British from land, sea, and air. With both sides operating in near total darkness, the British threw flares up near the peak of the mountain to light the Argentine positions up against the night sky. The Argentines' heavy weapons and snipers on the mountain made this a brutal struggle to the end. Then it became a firefight as the British tried to take the top of the mountain in the early hours of the morning. And finally, it devolved into barbaric hand-to-hand close-quarters combat as the British tried to seize the top of the mountain from Argentine Marines, eventually succeeding at 2:30 a.m. Certainly, nobody can accuse the Argentine conscripts of being inept or scared, though they were malnourished and in certain cases mistreated. Two conscript armies on the east flank of the mountain, desperately holding on, launched a counterattack at around 6:30 a.m. This failed, but like the Marines the night before, the Argentine conscripts had put up a valiant fight, eventually succumbing to one of the last great bayonet charges in military history. The battle for Tumbledown was over. The Argentines had lost, and they now retreated for the most part into Stanley. However, a group of Marines and conscripts stubbornly held on to Sapper Hill. The British thought taking this hill would be a formality. However, Menendez had cleverly laid mines around the base of the hill and positioned the Argentine heavy weapons to ensure maximum difficulty for the British. The Argentines were initially caught by surprise as the British dropped a unit of troops near the Argentine positions at the top of the hill. Although the Argentines had less casualties in this fight, the British were beginning to advance through the minefield, and with the conscripts providing covering fire, the Argentine Marines retreated back to Stanley. They were soon followed by the conscripts, and the British had now captured all of the positions west of the Falklands capital. Throughout this whole conflict, the English-speaking population of Stanley was made to mostly remain indoors. However, as the Argentine troops retreated back into Stanley, they prepared for a final battle in which the city would be fought for house by house. The 2,500 or so inhabitants of the town would need to give up their housing voluntarily to the Argentine forces. The Argentines would then use the population as human shields against British artillery. Rumors even began to spread on the Argentine side that some lieutenants were ordering their troops to kill any civilians who resisted. General Menendez was beside himself and did not know what to do. Not only was his force isolated against overwhelming odds, but Menendez personally was in a position to potentially be held responsible for any human rights violations committed. But Galtieri argued that he had more to lose. Galtieri had played a strong hand weakly and managed to piss off both the United States and most of Latin America. His bid for expansion had never been further from reality. But Galtieri also knew that the only way out was to fight his way out of it. The president told Menendez to counterattack with all his men. The intent of trapping the British front lines, pushing them back from Stanley, and elevating the body count to unacceptably high levels for the British public. The hope was that a ceasefire would lead to a British withdrawal, which would allow Galtieri and the Argentine army to save face, no matter what the final fate of the islands. In this same phone conversation on June 14th, Galtieri also threatened Menendez, reminding him that surrender is illegal for an Argentine commander unless he has lost at least 50% of his men and 75% of his ammunition. Menendez told him that a battle would lead to an extended loss of life in Stanley among civilians, some committed by their own side, in addition to an unprecedented military defeat. Galtieri then told him, "The responsibility for victory today resides with you." The phone call ended, with Menendez realizing he would not receive any support from Galtieri in the central government except with which to fight. Menendez then began to explore the possibility of surrender. Menendez later claimed that a major factor was his desire to not see any civilians harmed and to stop the possibility of atrocities being committed against civilians by his own side. Whether it was a result of Menendez's actions or not, there were luckily no civilians harmed during the campaigns around Stanley. After negotiating with the British all afternoon, Menendez officially surrendered all Argentine forces in the Malvinas to British Major General Jeremy Moore. Galtieri knew the jig was up. He also knew that the one country most important to his imperial ambitions didn't back him up, and in fact backed his enemy. Galtieri made this clear to the Argentine people the next day in his official concession speech to end the war.
Enfrentaron con más coraje que armamento la abrumadora superioridad de una potencia apoyada por la tecnología militar de los Estados Unidos de Norteamérica, sorprendentemente enemigos de la Argentina y de su pueblo.
Despite knowing that the invasion had been a failure, Galtieri was still not giving up on the war itself or his presidency. That evening, although a small group of protesters had already gathered outside the Casa Rosada, Galtieri decided to have a national rally of unity in the same place, right outside the presidential palace. The crowds turned up, but mostly to jeer at the palace and Galtieri. When the police and pro-war protesters arrived, this turned into a pitched battle on the streets, similar to the anti-junta protests that had started the war in the first place. If these bloody clashes did not convince Galtieri that he was no longer popular, it would soon be proven to him from within. About a week earlier, Pope John Paul II had visited Argentina to encourage peace. The Pope urged Galtieri to consider peace over a martyr's death in the Malvinas. The fact that Galtieri had continued to fight and still lost unconditionally meant that his credibility with the Argentine people was completely destroyed, The people wanted the islands, but more than that, they did not want defeat, and they did not want their boys slaughtered. Although Argentina had surrendered in the Falklands, Galtieri was considering not recognizing the surrender and continuing the war, which had officially not ended yet. However, the rest of the junta, except for Anaya, found this unacceptable and declined Galtieri's proposal on the 17th to continue bombarding the Falklands with the Air Force. Head of the Air Force Lamidozzo said he would not do it. The next day, a contingent of Argentine military officers came to Galtieri before the sun had even risen and asked him to resign. The general realized there was no way out. And on the morning of June 18, 1982, Leopoldo Galtieri resigned as president of Argentina and retired permanently from public life. However, he would not be able to stay out of the spotlight forever. After resigning as president, Galtieri and his wife Lucia moved to an army-owned retreat in the countryside. In mid-1983, as Galtieri's successors oversaw the transition toward a multi-party system, the government pardoned all of the military officers, including Galtieri, who had been involved in both the Dirty War and the Falklands War. However, just a few months later, after the October 1983 election, Galtieri was arrested by the new Democratic government in December of 1983. Over the next 2 years, Galtieri was a subject of the so-called Trial of the Juntas. Galtieri was personally charged with both human rights violations from the Dirty War era and with mismanaging the Falklands War. Galtieri was cleared of the charges stemming from the Dirty War in December 1985, but he was convicted the next year of badly mismanaging the Falklands War, including putting the lives of his own troops at risk. For this, Galtieri was sentenced to 12 years in prison. However, he only served 3 years before being pardoned again in 1989. By this point, though, he had been stripped of his rank, and Galtieri lived out the remainder of his existence living on an $1,800 a month army pension. He lived comfortably in a suburb of Buenos Aires and always declined interview requests. However, one more Galtieri TV moment was on the cards. In May 2002, the 75-year-old General Galtieri made his first public appearance in 7 years. He had been invited to the Argentine Army Day festivities in Buenos Aires. However, Galtieri was still a controversial figure, and nobody knew exactly who had invited him. Journalist Martin Ciccioli, known for his combative tabloid-style interviews, began asking all the other officers present who invited Galtieri, and nobody knew. Ciccioli then approached the general himself. Galtieri had declined most interview requests in prior years, and thus was not willing to talk. Ciccioli continued to push him on who had invited him here, and whether he felt like he deserved to be there. A tired-looking Galtieri attempted to shoo the reporter away. However, he would not budge. Finally, he got Galtieri to talk. The general said he had zero regrets about the way he had handled the war and would do it all again. But later that August, Galtieri was set to be on trial again as he was charged with the three murders from the 1977 case in Rosario of the three Spanish gone missing. The general was charged along with 27 other former officials. However, Galtieri's trial was postponed due to his diagnosis in August of 2002 with pancreatic cancer. In January of the following year, Galtieri's health failed him, and on January 12, 2003, Leopoldo Fortunato Galtieri passed away, leaving behind an immensely complicated legacy. Galtieri had taken Argentina to status as a regional power that it had never enjoyed before, and his expansionist ideas, both to the west and to the Falklands, were popular amongst many in the country. But despite his patriotism, Galtieri's career was bloody, as he rose to power on the back of the Dirty War and then took the presidency with the promise of actual war. According to Galtieri, the deaths in both these conflicts were necessary to prevent the spread of communism and international influence to Argentina. But it was the second half of this role that tripped him up in the end. While Galtieri was the strident anti-communist the Americans wanted him to be, he created influence infighting and instability within the Western Bloc, as it forced the United States to pick a side between two of its allies. In the end, there was never any doubt that the United States would choose to arm Chile and Great Britain over Argentina, no matter how close Galtieri was to the Reagan administration. Ultimately, this would bring about his downfall. This geopolitical bungling and subsequent defeat would stain Galtieri's legacy, as these foreign policy miscalculations are often blamed for causing the war, which was viewed internationally as largely pointless bloodshed. Meanwhile, in Argentina, some nationalists continue to view Galtieri as a hero, the only president bold enough to take the Malvinas, just part of the polarizing and complicated legacy of the general, the president, the conqueror, Leopoldo Fortunato Galtieri. Hey, if you enjoyed this video, remember that coming soon, it's our first ever mega series of full-length dive into the fascinating post-imperial politics of Europe. It's the collapse of Austria-Hungary and the almost Anschluss. Next up on Way Back History. Stay tuned.